Okay, it must be Monday. This is ThinkTech Talks, and it's the SOEST hour from 1 to 2 every Monday. SOEST, the School of Ocean and Earth Science and Technology, one of my favorite schools in the whole university. And we have three people who are representing this issue, and not necessarily all from SOEST. We have one from SOEST, right?
Two.
Graduate of SOEST.
Graduate of SOEST. Oh, okay. it is all now revealed. The graduate is Greg Wong, and he's with Hawaii Seawater Air Conditioning Company. And they're trying to build air conditioning out of seawater, using cold seawater from the bottom, kind of like OTEC from the ocean out, Makai of Kaka'ako. Huh? But Makai means seaward, so I guess I really mean oceanside of Kaka'ako. This is very important. Okay, we have Christina Comfort. She is with SOEST. She is an oceanographer there. And we have Luis Vega. Okay. I knew him when he was with HNEI, the Hawaii Natural Energy Institute. Is he still with?
Yeah.
Okay. And also he's with SOEST. Is SOEST part, or rather is HNEI part of SOEST? Oh,
yeah.
Okay. So you learn something every day. And he's what they call a specialist. And the reason they say he's a specialist is because he's a very special person. Luis and I had a show a couple, 3 years ago, which was really very interesting about seawater. Anyway, okay, so the title of our show is Cool Options for Seawater, and that's a double entendre, because it's all about cool. We're going to learn about that. Of course, I also say it's air conditioning from the deep. So let's go with you first, because you're the news person. I mean, such as there is news here.
Yep.
And that's Greg Wong with Honolulu Seawater Air Conditioning. You know, 10 years ago, you guys came to town from Minneapolis and created this company that was going to provide air conditioning, cold water for air conditioning, at a temperature that the downtown buildings could use in lieu of using the existing chillers there.
Correct.
This was going to save an enormous amount of electrical energy, because the chillers chill the water that goes into the air conditioning using electrical energy. So if you don't have to use that electrical energy, if you can get cold water into the building by a pipe instead, you can save all the energy you use on all these very expensive chillers. And so enter Honolulu Seawater Air Conditioning. Now, 10 years later, Greg, where are we?
Where are we? Permitting, a very intensive permitting process for this project. We're almost done. We have a federal EIS to complete. We have had that to complete for a long time, but we're pretty confident it's going to happen. So all of our permits are well underway, if not completed. So that was a huge part of this project.
It's a huge part of every project.
Yes, well, especially the seawater air conditioning project, because if you build a building on the island, you get maybe state and city county permits, but we're actually bridging both state and federal. We're going to go offshore, so there's federal jurisdiction involved, and sometimes there's blurred lines there between state, city, and federal, where people have different permitting
processes.
So
you cross all three of them.
We cross all of them and intertwine with all of them. So it's a huge process for this project, and probably not more so than other projects of similar
totally
size.
Understand. Yeah. You must have millions into applying for these permits by now.
I don't know what the number is, but it's a substantial amount of the work that's gone into this.
Yeah.
Another part is just the constructability. How do you build something like this? Obviously, we've got to dig in the streets in Honolulu. There's a lot of existing infrastructure. Where are you going to put the pipes? Where are you going to do it? So we did all the detailed design work. It's gone out to bid. Companies have actually bid on the work, and we have contractors lined up to do it.
So you're ready to go. All you need is the last permit or two, and you'll be ready.
There's four major
spring.
Yeah, there's four major hurdles here: the permitting, the constructability, designing it, getting people lined up to actually do it for a set price. I mean, how much is it going to really cost? By the way, it's inflated about 2 to 3 times when we initial. Yeah.
The longer you have to wait, the more expensive it is.
Sure. And then there's the financing. Who's paying for this? We're not federally, or there's no state tax credits, no grants or anything like that. It's all financed through private banking. sort of similar to building a building or something. We're going to do 80% debt on a normal construction loan and 20% equity from equity investors. So,
did you ever get special bond authority from the legislature?
We do have special purpose revenue bonds from the state. Yeah. Although, from my understanding, I'm no bond expert or tax expert, but they just allow you an avenue to finance and where banks will potentially give you a better rate to finance a project such as this. There's no real incentive to us as a company. You know, we're not getting any tax breaks or anything like that. Just it can help us get financing a little easier. But as far as actually giving us dollars in the pocket, that doesn't really happen for us. So we do have that avenue. And actually, when the interest rates were super low, as they have been, it's almost arguable you could go to the private market and finance it cheaper than getting a tax exempt bond. So I mean,
so you haven't used the tax exempt.
No, we still have them. We're actually back at the legislature this year, reapplying for some of them because it's taken so long that they're actually lapsing.
The authority expired. Yeah. Oh, that's too bad.
It's just the process we have to go through to extend them. Something
about the patience of Job.
Yeah, exactly. Patient money.
Okay.
And then the fourth major hurdle is actually getting people on board that are going to subscribe to the service. I mean, ultimately, we need to show that there's people out there that are going to spend their money with us as a company to purchase cold water, that the banks will feel comfortable that we have secure enough customer base that will be paying their bills into the future to lend us $200+ million to build this project.
Is that the size of that scope?
Yeah, well, I mean, actually, the end of the day, it's going to be closer to $300 million to build it. But, so those are the four major.
This is for downtown. Hurdles. So if I paint a word schematic of what it is, it's a pipe that goes offshore. Outside the medical school there in Kaka'ako? Is that
correct,
where the pipe goes?
In front of the Kaka'ako Park there.
And it goes down how far? It goes off the shelf under the surface of the ocean. It goes down how far?
We'll be about 1,750 feet of depth. And that's 4.5 miles offshore.
Okay, four and a half miles to go out there all the way. And when it goes out there, it's lying on the bottom?
Correct.
Okay, and then it drops down to 750 feet and then brings cold water down from back from the bottom. And this goes into a pumping station, which will be somewhere along Ala Moana, around 677 Ala Moana.
Correct.
And the pumping station will pump it to all the buildings who are customers. Well, I guess you go up Alakea Street, and then people will take the water off the main pipe that would run up through Alakea Street. Is that it?
Actually, Alakea we're not touching.
Okay.
Bishop Street is our main artery. Bishop, Punchbowl, Poikena, and Calvay Streets sort of our main arteries.
Major.
One major part here, and maybe a little misleading of our name, Honolulu Seawater Air Conditioning. We use the seawater for the cooling, but we actually pump fresh water. So in the pumping station, there's heat exchangers there that physically separate the seawater from the fresh water. So we're actually pumping fresh water through the streets.
And that's important because the seawater would corrode everything.
Correct, yeah.
Fresh water is a closed system.
Yeah, so we'll have a closed loop going to the customers. There's no seawater introduced into people's buildings. And I think we've educated people enough that they sort of know that now. But the seawater air conditioning system that we're developing.
Now, this kind of schematic is a proven schematic. System because affiliated companies and other companies have built this kind of thing along bodies of water on the mainland and elsewhere in the world.
Yeah? Correct.
So whenever you have water with a shelf where you can get cold water and pump it up, you're able to do this kind of technology.
But even lakes utilize it, and they don't really utilize a shelf per se. They just in colder climates where the lakes stay cold. Mm-hmm. I like to break it up into two technologies. One is what we're sort of talking about, the offshore water, and the using that as a temperature source, or the coldness, we say. But there's also the district energy side of it, of pumping cold water or even hot water around cities to provide cooling or heating, and that technology is hundreds of years old in the heating side. And cooling, they do it with conventional chillers or other means as well. But when you can marry up the two with the renewable source of the ocean and the ability to have a district of cooling, which downtown is, we marry those two technologies together and we get a very efficient cooling system. So, I mean, the district energy systems of cooling are prevalent around the world even more so than the deep water cooling systems. Deep water is used for cooling for, or maybe not deep water, but water is used for cooling for power plants and whatnot. So it's kind of using the best of all of our technologies and the location of Hawaii and downtown and the density of the air conditioning to marry those two technologies together.
So when the water gets to the building, then it goes directly, this is fresh cold water, it goes directly into the air conditioning system the same way the water from the chiller would have gone into the air conditioning system. And it passes through, and then it comes back out again through the exchange again and again.
Correct.
And the seawater that comes in to cool in the exchange at the 677 Ala Moana area, that goes back out into the ocean, and presumably after the exchange it would be warmer.
Correct.
Okay, so we're going to talk about that with all our experts here.
Yeah.
Okay, so finally, when you do this, you don't need a chiller anymore.
Correct.
And all the energy you use for electric power to cool the water in the chiller, you don't need that. So you save a lot of money for a big office building anyway.
Yep. There's also money saved in water and sewer costs because you use water and sewer. And that's another environmental benefit to using a seawater air conditioning system. Also eliminating the maintenance and operations cost for that equipment. It's not cheap to own and maintain.
That's true. Then they always break, don't they?
They tend to break. They're not known for their 100% reliability. And then also the capital cost, what we call our capital cost. You got to buy that equipment.
Expensive.
Initially, when you purchase a building or you build a building, you buy that equipment. For buildings that are existing, they're looking at about a 20, 25-year life cycle on that. So you got to go out and buy new equipment. So there's additional money saved there. So not only the energy savings, there's substantial savings in other areas as well.
So when you hook up the Honolulu Seawater air conditioning to the air conditioning in one of these big buildings, what do you do with the chiller? It's a big thing. It's heavy, and as you say, it requires maintenance. You can't just leave it there, can you?
You can. And that's probably what we recommend, but that's probably a very likely scenario for some of these properties. It's expensive to remove some of this equipment, but you can just leave it. Some buildings are concerned about reliability of our system, so they might look at maintaining their existing or the stuff that's there, and just in case they have something they can turn on. But some properties on some of the other district energy systems, district cooling systems around the world, they've removed that and utilized that space for other things, such as like in Stockholm where these systems are prevalent. They used to have a lot of rooftop air conditioning units. Well, the developers, once they were able to remove that equipment, they were able to build another 5 or 6 stories of high-end commercial or residential
space.
Above. And turn that into actually revenue generating. So that's what we see as the biggest opportunity for, if you were to remove the equipment, there's a potential for adding value to your property. Yeah. But the simplest one is you could just leave it there.
Leave it there, and in case for any reason your system goes down, they can
it's a potential,
fire up
yeah.
the old
yeah.
one again,
though, I
assuming
mean
it still works.
That's one of the biggest challenges of selling this system is having people understand the reliability of it.
That's the thing. I mean, make yourself a tenant in one of these buildings. Make yourself a national tenant in one of these buildings. Air conditioning goes down. The windows do not open. You can't breathe after a hot day. And the next day, you're going to be really unhappy, and you're going to be out there on the street complaining and telling the landlord that you want to be compensated for the loss of business because nobody could get into the office.
Exactly.
So reliability becomes everything for the landlord.
Correct.
And insurance, too.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll take a short break now. Now that we've had that exposition, and we're going to flower this conversation out to the science. Is that agreeable?
Yes,
all right.
Sounds good.
Okay. Everybody seems to agree. Okay. Greg Wong from Honolulu Seawater Air Conditioning, and Christina Comfort, an oceanographer at SOEST, where science lives. Science lives, and Greg knows this because he graduated that school. What was your degree anyway?
Ocean engineering.
Okay. And Luis Vega from SOEST, and within SOEST, HNEI, one of my favorite organizations, and that stands for the Hawaii Natural Energy Institute. He's there, a very special person. Okay, we'll be right back after this break.
On YouTube, or Olalo.
So come join us on Thursdays at 4 p.m.
I'm David Day.
And on Tuesdays at 4 p.m., I'm Hong Jiang.
Aloha.
Hi, my name is Dr. Rafi. Every week, I'm right here at ThinkTech Hawaii, 3 p.m. on Mondays. My show is Bartz's Bio Briefings. What do we do here? Well, we watch sperm swim. We see if they catch anybody. We check out the latest biosimilars. You know, the kind that, what was his name? The guy with the bicycle? I guess we forgot his name, but he was taking EPO and other human growth factors. We'll be talking about human growth factors. You want to know where to get some? Maybe I'll tell. Anyway, you can catch me, as I said, every week right here, Monday, 3 p.m., ThinkTech Hawaii, Dr. Rafi. You can also find me on Twitter, BioInfo Medical. Or you can catch me on Facebook, Dr. Rafael Boritzer. I'll be happy to converse with you. Aloha.
Okay, we're back. We're live. We're here at ThinkTech Talks in the SOEST Hour. It's actually, you know, energy. This is really about Hawaii, the state of clean energy, because we're really talking about clean energy today. We've heard from Greg Wong about, you know, the essential layout of the Honolulu Seawater air conditioning project. And we're going to get to exactly how it works scientifically, its history scientifically, and what it means in the landscape of clean energy. It's really important. So let's turn to you, Luis. You're with HNEI. You've studied seawater and its characteristics and the science of ocean thermal, I guess. Could I call it that?
Yes, yes.
Tell me, where did this all get started? Did it get started with OTEC or what?
Oh, definitely. The reason why I got interested in seawater air conditioning, or should I say the use of deep ocean water for seawater air conditioning, it was really as an entry into ocean thermal energy conversion. When we're doing the design for the plant that we operated, NELH, for 93 to 98, long time ago, in doing that, we decided that maybe one way to go about it, beyond our experimental plan for OTEC, will be to find a place where we could first set up, perhaps in a resort, set up an air conditioning system using the seawater, and then the next step would be to actually do the OTEC plant. It's amazing. I have a paper here that I wrote with a couple of colleagues and friends in 1991 talking about that. And what I learned in doing that, and I haven't really revised the numbers since then as to the economics, was that the technologies, there are no challenges for the technology for seawater air conditioning. But for example, to give you an idea of how energy efficient it will be, or it is because it's a reality. In Waikiki, one of the biggest resorts in the whole world, by law, you're gonna have more than about 30,000 rooms. That means our power company has to have 25 megawatt of installed capacity just to take care of that air conditioning. If you were to use 10% of that, 2.5 megawatt, you could pump all the water you need to air condition the whole of Waikiki. So it's a 90% savings in energy. But now, how much would it cost to implement that system, and how about the payback period? At the time, we came up with about 5 years of payback in 91 for the going rates of electricity.
That's good.
But that is easy for us as engineers, as scientists to say, but how do you go about doing it? And can you imagine that trying to dig trenches throughout Waikiki to bring the fresh water that will be cooled with the seawater, like Greg described before, into all these hotels? We will never be able to do
that. It's the same problem as downtown. It's ultimately a social and community problem.
It is a huge challenge. But having said that, though, what is important to me, because my ultimate goal is to implement ocean thermal energy conversion, is that this is like an entry level. I'm saying that because, for example, as we speak, there's a company, a U.S.-based company working in the U.S. Virgin Islands in the Caribbean, and they're going to do just that. The first step is going to be to implement seawater air conditioning in a resort, and then they're going to add the OTEC component. And a Dutch company is doing the same right off Colombia, the country Colombia. So it is beginning to happen, but once more, I see it as the step towards what I want to get, that is to get into ocean thermal energy conversion to produce electricity and desalinated water. Another potential entry level for the use of seawater, you kind of mentioned it before, is that I managed to get an offshore company in Houston as you probably know, when these outfits go out to look for petroleum, for oil, they basically set up a complex. It's like an industrial complex in the middle of the ocean, you know, deep waters nowadays.
Al Yee.
He's
a local engineer.
That's different, yeah.
It's different, okay.
Yeah, yeah. So what they need between 100 and 200 megawatt just to run all the pumps and compressors. And when they get gas, they want to compress it to liquefy it and ship it back to land. And they already have permits, and they do that. They use the surface water of the ocean to cool their compressors. But if they could use deep ocean water, the amount of increased efficiency will be such that it would pay back by itself real quickly. So these companies are looking into using the deep ocean water to cool their compressors. And the hope is that once they get comfortable dealing with that, we'll be able to add a module, we mean in the society at large, add a module to produce electricity with OTEC and have OTEC provide all the energy required for these petroleum corporations, basically.
So how do you produce energy with ocean thermal cold seawater? How do you do that?
You know, our electricity production?
Yeah.
It's what we boating engineers call the Carnot cycle. Basically, what you do is there are two most important ways to do it, or well-defined ways, or well-researched ways to do it. And one is, for example, the one that we did in 93 to 98 on the Big Island was what we call open cycle OTEC. So you take the surface water and you expose it to a vacuum. And when you get the pressure inside this vacuum chamber to be below 3% atmospheric pressure, some of that water will flash into steam, what we call cold steam. And that steam is then sucked through a turbine by having at the other end of the turbine the cold water. That way you get the pressure differential across the turbine that allows you to produce electricity. And we did that, and the steam, of course, is desalinated water. So that's also useful.
So you have a secondary benefit, yeah.
Yeah, and we did that 24/7 for 5 years. The other system is using what we call a working fluid.
The steam goes through a turbine and creates electrical energy. Yeah.
Okay. Another way to do it is you use what is called a working fluid. In this case, you can use a hydrous ammonia or some other organic fluid. And you pressurize the fluid such that when it's exposed to a heat exchanger to the temperatures of the surface water, it will then vaporize and will create a vapor that can also be run through a turbine. And of course, to be able to run things through the turbine, you have to suck it through, and you do it by having a lower pressure at the other end, and that's accomplished with the cold water. So you need both the warm water and the cold water to do that. Mm-hmm. And that gives you produce electricity. And
okay, so in NELHA, N-E-L-H-A, Hawaii Natural Energy Laboratory of Hawaii
Authority,
which is actually one of the clumsiest names of any government agency anywhere. But there you have cold water in the pipe right outside because NELHA along the Kona coast has a very deep drop-off,
yes, yes.
And it's close to the shore, closer than the 4 miles was talking about here.
But deeper.
So colder, and it's a great resource to have that. So you pump that up in a big pipe, and then you use that again instead of the chiller, and presto, you have air conditioning. And you guys did that for the office spaces, the buildings.
Oh, no, it's still being done.
Yeah, still now today at NELHA. NELHA runs on seawater air conditioning, the same kind Greg is planning for the downtown area, same technology.
Yes, yes.
And you did that, what, back in the 90s?
No, I shouldn't say we did. That was done by NELH themselves.
Yeah, but that was back when.
It's been going on for almost 30 years now.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Now, and so, you know, now you're working with OTEC, and you were involved with that red ship out there, the one that had a big OTEC along the side, Ocean Thermal Energy Conversion.
It wasn't really red, but that's okay.
Okay, whatever it was.
It's okay. It was green.
I'll have witnesses.
It was green.
We'll have witnesses in here in a minute.
It was green. No.
Okay, and you had that pipe going all the way down. Mm. This is before the fixed pipe was built. And you were...
You're talking about Miniotech,
right.
That's actually before my time.
You're not that old. Tell us
No, but one thing that I would like to pronounce is really important because, in a way, I'm here for selfish reasons, is that I was really fortunate to work with Christina, whom you're going to meet in a second. We had a conference with a marine biologist as to what parameters should we measure to try to determine the impact of ocean thermal. So first you want a baseline, and then you try to find out what happens once you actually do it. And there were so many different parameters that everybody wanted to measure because they all liked them. So I asked Christina, can you come up with a protocol that will come up with the minimal number of parameters that can be measured and still determine what's going on? And she did a wonderful job with that. And now she's actually working at SOEST, implementing that protocol to monitor what Greg is going to do. And the reason why I like that is because whatever they do would allow us, the people that want to develop all tech, to say, look, this has been done, it's similar, this is how you do it, this is how you monitor the environment.
So this is Christina's work, which we will hear about in a minute, will help you
as a scientist
in developing OTEC.
Yes, yes.
And OTEC is way, way bigger than seawater air conditioning.
Yes, yes.
You're not just taking chill water.
But this is not fair because we're here to talk about seawater air conditioning.
It's okay, but we should still put it in perspective. Mm. Yeah, yeah.
So we have to work together, basically, and trying to implement it. I should point out that the reason why this was not an issue, the monitoring part at NELH, is because in there, through their permit, because the small amounts of water used, they have what is called injection wells, so that they return the water to the ocean through these holes drilled through the lava rock, basically. And yeah. And that's monitored. Their quarterly reports, they measure all the parameters. So we know there's no impact after almost 30 years.
Yeah.
There's no impact. We know that. But then you ask, what would happen when you use that much more water? Would there be an impact? And the answer is that our mathematical models say no, but we need to find out by performing measurements.
Yeah, okay, and that's true. The amount of water that's involved in NELHA is a fraction of what would happen in Honolulu seawater air conditioning, right?
I'm not sure how much water they're pumping. I think it's about similar volumes, but I think what you're saying is they have the injection wells
right.
where we're actually discharging back into the...
Oh, I see. An injection well is when you discharge into the bottom of the ocean.
Rock, yeah.
So it doesn't have an immediate effect on the ocean itself. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow, exciting.
But you know what's important to point out is that like Greg mentioned, although he's trying not to really belittle the point too much or emphasize the point too much, is that it's taking them 7 to 8 years to get a permit to be able to put the water back in the ocean. And the way they put the water back in the ocean is where it will be a minimal impact to marine life. And you might say, well, maybe your mathematical model is wrong. Then allow Christina and her team to measure that and perhaps implement what is called adaptive management. So you tell them if you exceed this threshold, we will shut you down. Because I'm sure the threshold will never be exceeded because that water is going to want to go back below what is called the photic layer.
You know, the problem is you get this this kind of preliminary view of it and you have the precautionary principle
yes,
working.
Yes, yes, exactly.
You have no data about how it would actually, if you disagree, say so.
Yeah.
You have no data that how it would actually work, so you can't really do an intelligent measurement because it's not happening yet. So you're doing this theoretical measurement, which is not nearly as probative.
No, definitely. And the thing is, any computer model, any numerical model has to be calibrated with real data. Well, I'm all for it. I've been for it for years.
Yeah.
But we have to get the data. And the tough part is that to get a permit to get the data, you know, it's a chicken and egg kind of problem.
Yes, yes. Well, what I really like about this and having you all here is that this is an example, as Tom Apple always says, of the university outreaching into industry, out into the community, and providing its special knowledge and special research resources and capabilities in order to help the community. I see that happening. Mm-hmm. If he were here, he'd be happy that you guys are doing this and working together with Honolulu Seawater Air Conditioning. I mean, what could be more perfect? Mm-hmm. It's a clean energy effort, and it's based on science. These guys are the experts. So together as a community, we make it happen. It's a good thing.
Yeah, if I had a message for seawater air conditioning, it's just from the technical perspective, not finances, not implementation, is the fact that you're going to save 90% of the energy to produce the same amount of air conditioning load. I mean, that is, nobody can dispute that.
It's a no-brainer.
Nobody can dispute that. Now, of course,
we actually don't like that terminology anymore because
it does
take quite a bit of evaluation, and so. But
okay. Well, in any event, you'd sooner use, am I right, chill water coming up from Honolulu Harbor into Greg's facility here, than use PV cells on the roof of these buildings, or for that matter, use OTEC generating electricity to run the chillers. The most efficient of those possibilities is simply take the chill water out of the ocean run it through the chiller, run it through the
air conditioner. Would it make sense to use OTEC to make electricity and then to use the electricity to essentially mimic?
Logically inefficient, yeah.
I'm 100 times, 100 times more efficient to use the seawater than to generate electricity. Because that's the number I have in my head.
No,
is that
ten times. Ten times.
Okay, only off by 1-0.
Okay, we're going to take a short break.
One of my friends.
And then we're going to have the jewel in the crown of our show.
Yeah. Oh, she's doing
Christina
a wonderful
Comfort.
Job.
And
one thing I wanted to emphasize is that the university is doing that to help the community.
Yes.
You know, they haven't been given a contract to do it. They're doing it with their own funds
That's
to help
great.
The community.
That's great. This is exactly what Tom Apple wants. Mm. This is what he did in Delaware when he was, doing research in Delaware. And this is a good thing. I mean, the university's effort and help here is really meaningful and as far as I'm concerned, should be well appreciated. Mm. Yeah. Anyway, so this is ThinkTech Talks and the SOEST Hour. Thank you, Talia Ogliori, for putting it together. Thank you, Eric Masutomi, for letting Greg come down today. Thank you, Eric. you would have come anyway, right?
Yeah.
We're talking about cool options for seawater in Honolulu. We'll be right back after this break. Castle and Cook, Hawaii. Investing in Hawaii, creating communities, and providing for the needs of our state. Collateral analytics. Empowering the real estate industry to make better informed property investment decisions. The Foreign Trade Zone. Bringing the benefits of the Foreign Trade Zone programs to Hawaii businesses and entrepreneurs. Galen Ho, a senior executive of BAE Systems, a global defense, security, and aerospace company. Hawaiian Electric Company and its affiliates Maui Electric and Hawaii Electric Light Company on Hawaii Island. The Hawaii Energy Policy Forum, incorporating diverse perspectives to design a flexible and forward-looking energy strategy. Hawaii Energy, the state's energy and efficiency program created to help Hawaii's residents and businesses adopt a clean energy lifestyle. Hawaii Gas, helping Hawaii achieve its transition to clean energy and a better energy future. Hawaii Pacific Health, bringing technology and teamwork together to transform healthcare in Hawaii. The High Tech Development Corporation, attached to DBED, is the state's leading technology agency. The Scheidler Family Foundation, supporting educational, cultural, and charitable organizations, including ThinkTech. We're back. We're live. We're ThinkTech Talks on the SOEST Hour, talking about energy, talking about seawater air conditioning for Honolulu. We call it Cool Options for Seawater with Greg Wong of Honolulu Seawater Air Conditioning, Christina Comfort, who is an oceanographer at SOEST, and Luis Vega, who is a specialist at SOEST and HNEI, Hawaii Natural Energy Institute. So it has come that time of our show for the jewel in the crown, namely Christina.
The future.
The jewel in the future in the crown. And she's been doing tests and with intake and outtake of water in an environment of seawater air conditioning. And she has some results that she needs to share with us. Tell us about your proposition, about your tests, and about the results.
All right, well, my team at University of Hawaii, we're a group of oceanographers, people who specialize in the physics of ocean systems, the biology of ocean systems, and the chemistry of ocean systems. And we're all working together to study the environmental impact of seawater air conditioning systems in the Hawaii ecosystem. And the reason that we're so interested in this project is because even though there are seawater air conditioning systems in other places around the world, this is one of the first times that it's being done at a large scale in a tropical system. And this is different from in a colder water system where you can get cool water from near shore, from shallow water. And to get cold water here, we need to go way offshore and into the deep ocean, as Greg and Luis have talked about earlier in the show. So the important thing from an oceanography standpoint is that the water that's deep in the ocean, we're talking about 500 meters, 1,600 feet, has very different chemical characteristics from where the water is returned to the ocean at about 100 to 140 meters, which is about 350 to 450 feet. So just to give you a sense of what the differences are, I just have just a quick little plot.
Hold it there and we'll come in close on it.
Yeah, these are just three different types of parameters. We have temperature, oxygen, and nitrate. Nitrate is a really important nutrient in ocean systems. And we're just looking at, on the top, this is where the return is happening, and here's where the water is coming from at the bottom. Mm-hmm. So for all of these parameters, you can see they're really different from the surface, or from the effluent zone to the intake zone. And one of the most important things is the nitrate, which is, as I said, an important nutrient. So we're doing a variety of monitoring to keep track of the nutrients, the oxygen levels, the temperature levels at these two sites. And right now, we haven't actually been able to do any kind of real-time monitoring it because the system isn't up and running yet. So what we're doing now is getting a good baseline. So we're out deploying moored monitoring systems with lots of different instruments to measure all of these parameters over the course of at least a year before before the construction
would
happen.
You put thermometers down at the place where the original intake would be, and then you put a thermometer on the surface, and maybe different points down along the way?
Well, we have a couple different ways that we're monitoring. So one of these things, yes, we put out moored instrumentation. We're primarily focusing on the return site. We've also had moored systems out at the intake site. And yes, so we measure, we have temperature sensors, we have salinity sensors, oxygen sensors, nitrate sensors. And those moored instruments stay there and measure consistently, so we can learn what are the natural fluctuations in the environment. And once we understand the natural fluctuations and natural trends, then when a seawater air conditioning system is operating, then we're able to discern more clearly what's an impact of the system versus what is just an impact of the natural environment.
The ultimate test would be is if you had water that was returned off the chiller, make that the exchanger, right? The one in 677. If that water is warmer than the water you took out, and you drop that back in, wherever you do, drop it back in, to look at that area where it is being dropped in and see if there's any adverse effect on anything, chemistry or sea life or anything. But you don't have that. So how can you make, you know, an accurate determination if you don't have a place where the water comes back in at the increased temperature? How can you?
Well, I mean, there's a couple different ways we've started to try to address this before the operation of the seawater air conditioning system. One of these is through numerical modeling, which Luis mentioned earlier. So there are a lot of people working on numerical modeling to try to figure out how the plume is going to move through the ocean, if there will be any nutrients that remain in the photic zone. One of the primary environmental impacts that could happen is that elevated levels of nutrients in a place where there's still sunlight could result in enhanced algal growth and enhanced primary productivity in the ocean system.
Like climate change, right? It's warmer than it was, so different things happen. Yeah.
Kind of. This is more in the sense of a fertilization. It would be, if that were to happen, it would be fertilization. And luckily, all of our numerical models so far are showing that the plume does have a tendency to sink. One thing that's interesting is that even though it'll be sinking, it is still going to, there is still going to be a steady state of elevated nutrients at some level away from the diffuser. So it's really a matter of how quickly can phytoplankton, is kind of organisms that use nutrients and sunlight to grow, how quickly can they uptake the nutrients before they sink?
So how wide an area do you look at in order to make these determinations?
Well, for now, we're really only capable of, we're deploying a mooring in a specific location that is basically at the end of the diffuser location at about 140 meters depth. And what we're able to see there is water, as water moves across it, we can see fluctuations from tidal changes, from seasonal changes, changes in wind patterns, things like that. We also go out on shipboard sampling missions where we take out one of the research vessels and capture water from different depths.
The Kani Loa, what do you call that ship?
Oh, the Kilo Moana.
Yeah.
Yeah, the research vessel Kilo Moana is one of our main ships. It's also SOEST also has the KOK.
The KOK, right.
Yes, those are the two.
What is it? Kani Loa? Keikoa o Kani Loa?
I think it's Ka'imi Kai o Kani Loa.
Ka'imi Kai o Kani Loa.
You know, I don't quote me on that. We just always call it the KOK.
KOK, right. It's down at Snug Harbor.
It's a
remarkable ship. Mm. It's got everything.
We've mostly been sampling off the KM so far, and we're also looking to sample off smaller vessels if we can.
So what is your conclusion so far?
Well, so far, we're just monitoring the baseline right now. So we are trying to understand what are the natural fluctuations in primary productivity in our nutrient levels that we expect to see in the temperature that's present in that intake and at the effluent site. And we're just really trying to gather up as comprehensive a data set as we can before the pumps start pulling water and depositing water. And
you'll be following it then, too.
So we'll be following it through the construction phase and through the beginning of operation to continue quantifying what's going on in the marine environment.
And then what? After the operation starts, you'll monitor it again? You'll continue to monitor it?
Yes, so just continually all the way through.
You want to see what's happening.
Yep.
With a view toward, if something problematic is happening, you'll let everybody know, you'll let Honolulu Seawater Recognition know they can correct whatever needs to be corrected. And if everything is just fine and there's no real damage or adverse effect to the environment, then that'll be good. And then that'll encourage more seawater air conditioning facilities around the state. You had something to add, Luis?
No, they would not really, but the one point that that I would like to make, because Christina is so immersed on this, is that we have to remember that even though this is theoretical, because we haven't discharged the water yet, returned the water, shouldn't use the word discharge, I guess.
Yeah.
Is that you need to have enough sunlight to be able to enhance primary producers, okay, the little phytoplankton and then zooplankton and so on and so forth that are part of the food chain. And the question is, how much light do you need? And we talk about the light intensity at the surface of the ocean, and then it begins to decrease what we call exponentially with depth. And some biologists will tell you, if you have 10% of the light intensity, you will enhance production. Some said, no, actually as low as 1%. And that in Hawaii means the difference between 70 meter depth or 140 meter depth, basically. So let's take the more stringent case, the case in which it says that the return water should end up below 140 meter depth. So if you design your system such that return water, what we call the plume, it's like a jet as it gets discharged, and this water, as it gets discharged and creates a current, begins to suck water from the sides. And so you have mixing between the ambient water and the discharge, the return water. Mm-hmm. I keep saying the word discharge. So the mathematical models show that we can end up with the water below the photic layer, whether it's the 1% or the 10% intensity or light intensity. But once more, we need to be able to actually perform measurements with real devices, with real water being returned, to be able to calibrate those models. So today, the models that we have that are really based on simple Newtonian physics, well known by us engineers for so many decades and centuries, actually, not decades, they indicate that that's the case. But of course, we need to find out how accurate our models are by having real data. But it's important to know you need, because a lot of people get worried about the fact that, oh my Lord, you're going to create this phytoplankton bloom. And people are trying to on purpose do that, haven't been able to do it.
Just to see what happens. Yeah.
A lot of people are trying to on purpose inject deep ocean water with high nutrients to create a bloom on purpose, but they cannot do it because the water sinks.
Let me understand. Where is the pipe that returns the water? Is it at the bottom also, like the pipe that takes the intake?
Yeah.
Or is it at a different depth?
Shallower. Yeah, and maybe just to back up a little bit, from a developer standpoint, this is all cost to build the system.
Sure.
The cheapest cost solution is to just discharge the water right at shoreline. We only have to build a pipe to the shore. But of course, there's environmental concerns and prohibits that. So what we've done is we designed a pipe back out into the ocean, paralleling our intake pipe. And then at a certain depth, and this is sort of what the topic of conversation is right now, is how deep do you need to go? The deeper we go, the more cost it is to us and the more cost to the customer. We'll actually run the pipe parallel to the intake pipe at a certain depth, where it's determined that the best depth of discharge or disperse the water becomes just basically a big hose, and we drill a bunch of holes in it for a certain
sprays
length.
Sprays out.
And then it diffuses out, and that's the word diffuser you hear.
Yeah.
We're not just have a pipe with an end and it's just all shooting out one spot, although I'm sure the alternative has been looked at as the lowest impact as well, and it was decided the diffusing procedure was the best or the lowest impact possibility. So I don't know, I can't remember off the top of our heads or the depth, you might know of what our better was. It's
100 to 140 meters.
So it starts at 100 meters, it continues down slope, and then 140 meters depth is where the holes end in our pipe. So that's how we return the water back.
I just wonder, I mean, I'm the only person present who has no training in this area. But it strikes me that if the water is warmer, the return water is warmer than the water that you have taken out, that if you put the warm water where the water is cold, you have a greater effect on the environment than if you put the return warm water closer to the surface, where the difference in temperature between the return water and the surface water is not that great. So am I right to say, you're the oceanographer, but am I right to say that you have less of an effect, whatever the effect might be, if you disperse, what's the word you use, to diffuse the water closer to the surface?
Well, actually, in this case, the cold water that comes up through the deep pipe and gets warmed, where it's returned, it's still colder than the ambient water. So the ambient water is about 18 to 20 degrees Celsius, about 70-some degrees Fahrenheit. And the return water, the water from the intake starts at about 45 degrees Fahrenheit and comes through the diffuser and comes out at about, what would you say,
58? 60 maybe.
So it still is colder and denser than the ambient water. And that's why the plume, even at 100 to 140 meters, still has a tendency to sink in our numerical models. Mm-hmm. It's because it is still denser. Mm-hmm. So even though it's still, even though it's denser, it still has all those nutrients in it. Even though it's been warmed up, it's denser than the ambient water, it wants to sink. All the nutrients and also low oxygen compared to surface water is still present in that water mass that's being returned. So that's what we're concerned about in terms of local environmental impacts. Mm-hmm. And yeah, whether it's, I think I mentioned it before, it's basically there is going to be a steady state of water being constantly pumped out of that diffuser. And there's going to be constantly, for at least some distance away from the diffuser, an elevated level of nutrients. And that's where you could see some primary productivity, and that's one of the main things that we're looking at.
Yeah, so interesting. Monitoring. And then this all goes forward, but I'm wondering, you spoke of an EIS that was still pending.
Yep.
Is the work that Christina is doing, and for that matter, Louise, I mean, is that work relevant to the EIS? Are you including these reports that Christina has shown us in the EIS?
I can't speak to the specifics of Christina's work being included, but yeah, I mean, I would venture out to say that the majority of the extended length of time it's taken us to complete the EIS has been primary. One of the major reasons is this reason, the discharge. I mean, there's a lot of other impacts that were looked at to the EIS process, but this has been one that's still being looked at. And actually, the inverse of the common thinking is we're returning warmer water out into a colder area. It's actually the reverse is we're introducing colder water into a warmer environment, so that's the concern, along with the nutrients and the low oxygen and some of the other things.
Yeah, but that strikes me.
How do you do that? How do you make sure that you're not going to have negative impacts, or what the impacts might be? How do you monitor? What levels do you say, hey, this is out of alignment with what we consider normal? So I think that's a lot of the work that Christine's doing.
And valuable.
Is valuable.
I just wonder, I mean, there are other seawater air conditioning facilities in the world. I mean, can we learn from the way the water and the environment was affected in those facilities and incorporate those lessons into our understanding now?
I think that's what you got to at the beginning. Mm-hmm. This is a unique
This is unique.
It is a unique system. It's really the first commercial scale system in a tropical location.
It's so the tropical location
being the really important
temperatures
part.
Are different.
Right.
Variations in temperatures.
Right. You have coral reefs on the mm-hmm. on the benthos are really important impact, and that's one of the reasons that the pipe got extended to as deep as it is now is because mm-hmm. of concerns about the high nutrient water settling on the benthos where there's still coral reefs growing. Mm-hmm. So so at 100 to 140 meters, you're below the kind of traditional coral reefs. You still could get mesophotic reefs in that zone. So there still is about 300 feet or so. There's still mesophotic corals. But sure. it's kind of outside of the part of the reef that, for instance, would be beneficial to tourism and that kind of thing, like where people go
down. 4.5 miles out. That's
well,
a
the discharge,
strong
the discharge.
Swimmer.
The intake's 4.5 miles out. The discharge is, I don't know,
closer
the actual linear
it's
length.
Maybe
is
a mile or so.
A mile. Well, that's still a
still, it's still a ways, yeah.
So we only have a minute left, and I wanted to ask my last question to you guys. Where does this technology fit in the world of renewable energy in Hawaii? You know, I mean, we have so many resources, and I'd be interested in your thoughts about where it fits, you know, going forward in the next how many decades. So we have wind, we have solar, we have geothermal. One of these days when the material science gets you know, more refined, we'll have real O-Tech, I think.
Well, but yeah, but why you say material science? Is that
my understanding is O-Tech is incomplete for the lack of an inexpensive material to do the exchange. I'm wrong about that?
That is you're worrying about the dimes, I'm worried about the dollars.
It's got to be economic, yeah.
Yeah, but the economy has more to do with the fact that the largest O-Tech plant we ever managed to operate was about a 0.25 megawatt, and in our economic analysis, when I said our, it means the whole community, shows that you get to 100 megawatt plant.
Okay, well let's treat for this question as O-Tech is a real possibility.
Yeah, but what's important is what the question you asked before is residence time. How long is this plume going to be at that layer?
Okay,
people forget that part about the residence time.
The question question is where does this fit in our renewable energy portfolio, because we're working on a number of fronts here. We have a number of possibilities. Where does this technology fit? Do you see it proliferating to other areas in the state? Which areas and for what purposes? I mean, this is a great experiment in some ways. You know, it's an experiment as far as SOEST is concerned.
Don't tell him that it's an experiment.
Or don't tell anybody else.
When I say experiment, I mean an experiment in the development of clean energy as a factor, you know, a percentage of the total clean energy.
Well, you know, everything helps. And like I said before, for 10% the amount of energy, you can have the same AC load available. But of course, you could do it in downtown Honolulu. You could do it in Waikiki. You could do it in what we call the second city. But you know, so there's a good substantial, maybe 10% of the installed capacity in Oahu could be replaced with a
Do you think it will be?
Could be.
What stands in the way?
I would say what stands in the way is the difficult and arduous road, the process to getting the permits. It's really tough.
Well, and just the constructability of a system.
Yeah, because what we're worried about, and we should, we're worried about the environmental impact, but we don't compare these technologies to the alternatives.
You know, that's my question.
Yeah, how much longer can we continue burning fossil fuels?
Yeah.
And what is the impact of those fuels in the environment? We don't get credit for that.
So let me throw one thought at you, and you can react. And we're really out of time here.
Sorry. But
seems to me that if we want to move ahead and give a greater place for seawater air conditioning in the state, one thing we have to do is change the permitting process. Do you agree or disagree?
I would weigh in on this. Permitting, I think, will be a groundbreaker. You know, anyone to follow this one will have a much easier time. So I think the permitting, it's there. It's there for a reason, and it's doing its job. However, you know, any simplification obviously will help reduce costs. But some of the bigger costs are just to build the system and to get it operational. And those are, to me, those are the real barriers, because, you know, there's people out there willing to finance it. There's people out there willing to build it. So, you know, it's a reality today. The people that actually are the end users and are ultimately going to say that this is going to happen or not, they're ultimately going to make these systems go or not and be a benefit. And it's a great diversification for them on their energy portfolio. There's wind, there's solar. Downtown Honolulu has a great opportunity to participate in a system that not very many other people in Hawaii will be able to.
That's Greg Wong, Hawaii Seawater Air Conditioning Company. Christine Comfort, an oceanographer with SOEST, and Luis Vega, a special person with HNEI and SOEST. Thank you so much all for discussing cool options for seawater.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jay.
Aloha.